Hello, I'm Ty Mason of the DiabetesCouncil.com, researcher, writer, and I have type 2 diabetes. Today I'm going to answer the question, what is the glycemic load? But before we get into that, make sure you download my free diabetes management book, which also includes a diabetes grocery shopping guide, foods to eat and avoid, by clicking the link below. Now, as a person with diabetes, there are certain terms and tools we all need to know about in order to keep our blood sugar under control. One of the best tools available, in my opinion, is the glycemic load, or the GL. The GL takes into account more than the glycemic index. For a more in-depth look at the GI, please watch our video, What is the Glycemic Index? We know that a food with a high GI raises blood sugar more than a food with a medium to low GI. But the glycemic index fails to take into account the amount of net carbs in a food. So glycemic load is a better indicator for how a carbohydrate food will affect our sugar. There is a problem with just using the glycemic index. This is because researchers calculate the GI value of foods based on identical portions delivering 50 grams of carbohydrates. Glycemic load takes into account the GI and the amount of carbohydrates eaten. This is a much better indicator because it reflects both the type and amount of dietary carbohydrates and is much more practical for everyday use. You see, what the glycemic index doesn't tell you is how high your blood sugar could go when you actually eat the food, which is particularly determined by how much carbohydrates are in each serving. A food with GL of 10 or less is considered low. A food with a GL of 20 is considered high. A prime example of a food that is misleading is the pineapple. The pineapple has a GI of 59. This might make us want to avoid it. But the glycemic load is only 7, and that's considered very low. Another example is the watermelon. The watermelon is a very high GI at 80. But a serving of watermelon only has 6 grams of net carbs, and the glycemic load is only 5. Conversely, some foods have a relatively low GI, but could have a high GL. A slice of vanilla cake with frosting sounds good. One serving, a GI of 42. That's low, but the glycemic load is 24, which is relatively high. Determining the glycemic load of a food is really simple. You take the GI, multiply it by the net carbs, and divide it by 100. That formula is on your screen. Now, you got to note that the net carbs are the total carbs minus dietary fiber. You may have to do a little math, but in the end, it's all worth it. It is my personal opinion that you use the glycemic load of a food rather than simply the GI. It's a much better indicator as to how food will affect your blood sugar after you eat it. So let's do a quick example of how to determine a food's glycemic load. Let's take an example of corn. Now, the GI of corn is 49. You'll have to look that up. It's not on the nutritional content, but we know it's 49. Now, you multiply that by the net carbs. The net carbs, you take 31 grams of carbohydrates, as you see, but there's 3 grams of dietary fiber. So you subtract that. That gives us 28. That result of multiplying the GI times the net carbs is 1,372. You divide that by 100, and you get a glycemic load of 13.7. So corn is a low GI food, but it's a medium glycemic load food. I hope this answered your question, what is a glycemic load? Don't forget to get your diabetes management book by clicking the link in the description box below. And as always, let me know if you have any other diabetes-related questions. Thanks for watching. I'm Ty Mason.